I tell you, this week has been an interesting week as I've been doing the research for these three murders and the information and data that I've been looking at. And it's incredible the things that go on. That, and you know, this is not a secret. This secret here, I'll pop this in real quick. I know nothing. Evidently, he didn't know nothing, and no one else did either. Bob Crane. Bob Crane was an actor a lot of you guys know from Hogan's Heroes. And I've got a short story we're going to tell about that, and then we're going to get into a lot more stuff with the Hogan's Hero and Bob Crane. And Bob Crane's lifestyle was a very interesting lifestyle, and it's amazing that he probably didn't have something happen to him a lot earlier than it did, because he was, I believe, 49 years old. So we're going to tell the first tale, and it's Uno. And Uno is basically the first story in three murders. And if we can get through three murders tonight, they're set up for three murders. We'll see if that happens. And the most, the biggest star in the state of Arizona to die in a murder up to that point was Bob Crane. And Bob Crane was that guy that everybody just believed was the wholesome guy that just looked like the, you know, the quirky kind of a, not a tough guy, but a kind of a smart ass, but a, you know, a good looking guy that could manipulate his way around situations, scenarios. You kind of thought maybe he was like Colonel Hogan was, and that he could manipulate that. And that's really was a part of him, but it wasn't all of him. So I'm going to kick this on, and let's see if we can't get the first story. There's Cookie Monster, and there's Al Sampson. There's Tom, there's Jay, there's Eric, and A.H., and let's get the party started. On June 29th, 1978, the manager of the Winfield Apartments called the Scottsdale police. In room 132A was a body. A young female had went to the office saying she peered through the window and saw a figure in bed and blood splattered everywhere. Come to find out, she was an actress who was going to rehearse her lines with that individual. And that individual was no other than TV actor Bob Crane. Millions of people knew Bob Crane because of the show Hogan's Heroes. And when the police opened the door in that dimly lit room, what they found amazed them. Blood was splattered all over the wall, all over the ceiling. There was an electrical cord around his neck. Two large gashes under his ear. He was unrecognizable on the left side. How could this happen? How could this brutal murder take place and never be able to find someone that did the killing? Bob Crane started in show business as a DJ, a radio personality, and he had a knack for it. People seemed to like him. On his popular show, he would have people like Marilyn Monroe, Bob Hope, and a chance meeting with Carl Reiner, who was a well-known TV writer. And when he thought of a role in his hit sitcom, The Dick Van Dyke Show, he brought Bob in. Bob had other roles as well. And when a show about a World War II concentration camp, a prisoner's camp came up, he thought of Bob, and he called his agent. His agent was kind of confused when Bob didn't seem to be interested because he didn't want to do a serious drama. And he said, no, no, you've missed out. This is going to be a comedy. And Bob couldn't kind of understand how that could happen. Well, after six seasons and massive popularity, Bob became a star. And with that star came luxuries. You see, Bob's luxuries, he didn't drink, he didn't smoke. Bob was addicted to sex. And not only was he addicted to sex, he had a chance encounter with a gentleman named John Henry Carpenter. Now, Carpenter was a Sony salesman, and he had an ability to get film equipment. Now, remember in early 70s, no one had any video equipment. It wasn't available. It wasn't made yet. And even film at that time was very rare. So he allowed Bob to use all the equipment he needed to film pornography. And Carpenter loved to be able to be the sidekick of a popular Hollywood TV sitcom star. And Bob's ability and his good looks and his addiction allowed him to amass a collection of pornography that was unbelievable. Now, Bob did not for some reason understand that it was not a popular thing for him to be able to show people his Polaroid collection, thousands of people, and his pornography, his movies, his film. And he was on the set of a Disney movie and showing people the pornography, and they were aghast that he couldn't do that. I mean, that was not allowed in that era of time. So there lay Bob on that bed. How did it happen? How did he get here? How did he get to that place where destiny caught up with him? The police believed there could only be one person that could have done that, and that was Carpenter. 2 days before Bob Crane's death, he'd made a call to his son saying that he was going to divorce his wife, who was the second Hilga on Hogan's Heroes, and he was going to leave Carpenter as a friend and clear his mind and get a fresh start. And he had been in arguments with Carpenter before. Bob was working on the play at the Windmill Dinner Theater, Beginner's Luck. He was playing the lead character, and he was wanting to start his life anew. Things that don't make sense is that there was no entry, forced entry at all. And the hit was brutal and vicious. Not everyone could have been able to do that. Some people believe that it was a camera tripod that he was hit with. But he was laid face down. The police decided that it had to be Carpenter. And they looked in his car and there was blood, and there was supposed to be brain tissue, but somehow that disappeared. And the Scottsdale Police Department allowed people in the room and contaminated. They say they didn't, but they allowed people in touching and bringing in new evidence. And they did not conceal it. Now, remember also at that time, there was no DNA. So in 1992, they finally charged Carpenter with the death of Bob Crane. And after 2 years in 1994, they acquitted him. Lack of proof. Bob's son believed that it might also have been the ex-wife who he was getting ready to leave. So in 2016, John Hook, a reportive investigator who worked diligently on this case, took the DNA and had it analyzed by finally realizing that the blood in Carpenter's car was probably that of Carpenter's and of Bob Crane, and the DNA would tell them that it was him. And what they found out astonished people was that it was not the DNA of Carpenter. There was another person. Come to find out, Bob had made a deal with the devil. There was an LA crime mafia boss that had decided he wanted to be in the movie. So he decided, if I got Bob Crane in a pornography film, he would also finance another romantic comedy, but then Bob would also have to be in this pornography, in this porn film. And Bob even realized his career was over if he would have been in the porn movie. And they believe it was probably a hit from the LA crime boss. But even to this day, how does a character that millions of people know in a metropolitan city not be able to find out who the murderer of Bob Crane was? And maybe the true murderer of Bob Crane was addiction, his sex addiction. We'll never know. Or will we? Okay. The funny thing about that story, and if you find it funny, there's probably not a lot of things that are funny about that story, but there's so many different angles when you, the more you go into that rabbit hole and some of this true crime stuff. You know, there was never any proof that there was a pornographer, that there was any contract actually made between him. The thing about the death of Bob Crane also was that he was killed in his sleep. So he was sleeping. He didn't know it was coming, the death blow. He didn't know exactly where it was coming. He didn't know it happened when at the time it happened. So they say that he always locked his door. I don't know how they knew that, but they said he always locked his door. So it had to have been somebody he let in that room that he knew. There's so many weird things about that story. There's even a thought process that there was a serial killer in the neighborhood. Isn't that incredible? And I want to thank Mr. Eric C. for that right there. Number 28. The only thing I could come up with, Eric, and I don't know if it's bonus money, is that right here I put, where's it at? I don't even see it now, but anyway. And Cookie Monster, thank you very much for the cookies. And I like boxes of cookies myself. You know, the thing about these stories, when you get into them, they just keep going down. The true crime stories are fascinating when you look at the things that happened. You know, the fact that he was asleep in the bed, he wouldn't have just let anybody in. Another thing is, disgusting or not, there's some disgusting things that go along with this as well, is that he had his boxer shorts on. They said he never slept with boxer shorts on, and he was asleep. And so, you know, he must have let this person in. But you don't know. You know, that's the thing about all this. What's it say here? He does. He used an ultraviolet scanner to look for germs in his clan's oatmeal spittle. That must be where Wilford Brimley was strangled by Bob Crane. I don't know. You know, you know what's funny about that? And they said that there was, I don't know how you put this. How do you put this, like, non-grossly, that there was semen on his arm? Like somebody said, this was a big FU, right? This was about, you know, and it was it his partner in crime? You know, was it part of, look at the notes I've got on this crazy story. It's incredible. And they're all in green, you know? So it's unbelievable that Carpenter, John Henry Carpenter, was the character that was the Sony salesman, right? And he had the availability to get all this high tech stuff when you couldn't even get one. Nobody had a film, you know, in 78, nobody had any of this equipment available. And so they use this as, I'm going to use you and you're going to use me. We're going to use your stardom. You're going to be able to allow us to pick up women. And I'm going to be a part of that. Now, he did this in every town he went in. He did these shows all over. He was in Dallas and all the major cities. He's going to go to Albuquerque next. And each one of these cities, he enticed these women to come in. And, you know, the amazing thing that throws me is that they knew they were getting photographed and they knew that they had movie equipment. And it was just funny to me that they would be willing to do that, that they would be willing to get in the scene. Now, here's the thing also that gets really weird. You know, he had all this equipment. He had all these, I mean, thousands and thousands of videos. And he had all these books, these Polaroids. I mean, you're talking thousands. And he would show people on sets, and that's what got him busted at Disney. They were like, dude, you can't be showing people on the set this stuff. You know, it's like you're showing your baseball cards. So there was a disconnect with Bob Crane in the real world as well. You know, he wasn't a smoker and he wasn't a drinker. He said he would have an occasional drink, but that was more mainly just a scenario or a situation where, you know, he would use that to put some lines on women. And you know, was it a jealous husband? Was it a jealous boyfriend? Was it his partner in crime? You know, it you just don't know. And so they did a DNA test so many years later, and it ended up being, you know, that there's another guy, you know, a mover was doing. Now, if you go to his hotel room, which I'm going to do, or that room, I'm going to there. I don't know if I can get into the room itself. They also say there's massive paranormal stuff that goes on there. It's been traded out. You know, it's a condominium type of deal. And they said it's probably on a second or third owner. And there, and the rumor was it was massive paranormal stuff that went on in that room. And, you know, who knows? Who knows if that's true or not? They believe it was a tripod that he used. The theory is this. That Carpenter came into the room. He was going to get a ride from Crane to the airport that next morning. This is 3:30 or 3 in the morning, somewhere in this window, right? They had both tried to get a hold of these women. They had both struck out, and they probably never would have had this interaction, even in the same room, if they would have been a little more lucky, you could say. And so the funny thing was, Bob was going to take him to the airport at 10 o'clock the next morning, and Carpenter had a rental car. And so why would Bob take him to the airport if he had a rental car? It doesn't make any sense. And then there's blood in the rental car. Well, why would there be blood in your rental car? I mean, you know, the theory and thought process was because there was one tripod missing. They knew he had two tripods, and they had a tripod that was missing. And they believe that that's what hit what the death blow was. And they thought maybe he took that tripod and put it in his car, and some of the blood got off, you know, slid onto the door panels. And so there was blood in his car. And it's just so funny when you think about in that era as well, you know, here's a guy, and that apartment complex is big. It's not small. I mean, there's people all over. They're not very big rooms. It's almost like a motel if you look at it that way. And so you can't believe that somebody wouldn't have seen something that was going on, even though it was late at night. And then Carpenter gets back into Los Angeles, and then he calls the room. Now, when the woman that came in to find him, she still did not know it was him. She thought it was maybe some woman that committed suicide. She thought that maybe it was a man that killed himself. She thought maybe it was Carpenter. She didn't know. And this was her co-star in the play. And so she had did all this work and to try to, you know, and she was there being interviewed by the police in the room because it was hot outside. So here's another person traipsing through this mess. And so this crime scene was absolutely just horrible, the situation scenarios that they did this stuff. And, you know, Bob Crane's story is a story that could go on. I mean, you could do days on this thing and they have never found. And so Carpenter died. He died 4 years after his trial, I think in roughly 98. And the wife had died. You know, the funny thing is at the funeral, they had an all-star cast of characters, stars that were there at his funeral. And also, you know, he got to be buried as a movie star. And then his wife, ex-wife, who was going to be his ex-wife, she's buried right next to him. And on their headstone has got a picture of them when they were both in Hogan's Heroes. So it's kind of funny how things end up. Now, the son who wrote his own book also had Bob Crane pornography that you could go on and watch this pornography. I mean, you can't make this stuff up. You cannot make this stuff up. It is insane. It is crazy that they could make this kind of stuff up, but they did, you know, they did. I don't know what the oatmeal box is. But they say, you know, and he also had a cord wrapped around his neck, and it's like, what? I mean, this case, and it never got solved. And then again, other people, there were a couple murders in the area within the next 2 months of stabbings. And they said, well, that's not having anything to do with it. Another gentleman believes it was a serial killer. Who knows? I know Carpenter had something to do with it. You just don't have blood on your rental car. Come on. I mean, that's ridiculous. That is absolutely ridiculous. And so that time was the most popular movie star that had ever been murdered in the state of Arizona. And that was Uno right there. That was Uno. Now, one of the most disgusting, should I say disgusting, you know, or should I say dose. So what is dose? Dose is murder to hung well. The last man that ever was hung in the state of Arizona. And, you know, when you look at these characters, it's not like we don't believe that they deserved it. But boy, he went out. He might have put himself in a situation, but he went out. He went out hard. And who's not to say that he didn't deserve it? So let's go on to murder number 2. You know, this time of the year, everyone talks about horror and how scary maybe these movies are, but you know what's really the truth? The truth is real horror. How about a man that took 33 minutes to hang? Does that sound creepy? It is if you're at the end of that rope. And that night on Christmas Eve, Earl took that tomahawk and chopped his wife and his baby to death. Earl came out of this very door and waited to be sentenced. And the verdict ended up being death by hanging. So they brought Earl Gardner down below. So let's take a look into that rock quarry that's on the very bottom. Gardner spent 5 hours in that car waiting for them to call his name. And anybody who knows anything about hanging knows that the purpose of the rope is to break your neck. Didn't happen. Gardner was left dangling for 33 minutes. The sheriff finally walked over and put his foot on Gardner's shoulder and finished him off. And after that, there was never another hanging in the state of Arizona. That's the real horror of the Wild West. Now, this guy sat in the car, so there's nothing down there. So they took him to the bottom of the of that dam because he was on the reservation, and they took him there and they built the they built the scaffolding or the gallows while he waited. So he waited in that car like 6 hours for these guys to complete this gallows down below. And so he sat in that car with a priest. And, you know, the guy was a horrible person. So don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that, you know, he deserved what he got. But, you know, when you get to these stories and you look at the fact that here's a guy they let dangle, I guess just hoping that he would be dead, he wasn't. And you think about, you know, did he deserve to die that way? Did Bob Crane deserve to die that way? Did Dose end up being the story? I've always been fascinated by that story because if you do the history and you follow up. Now, a lot of guys, we talked about the ropes that they hang people with, and they are custom built. This guy's was not. I can tell you that already. They probably did not custom build his rope, I'm going to guess. And maybe I'm wrong. There's also a board that goes behind. We talked about that a little bit. They have that board at the Florence Museum that they put behind you when they drop you. And it's a pretty incredible thing to think that, you know, he waited in that car while these guys were drinking and putting the jobs together. And it wasn't like your most professional spot. And maybe it didn't need to be. You know, these guys, they didn't take a lot of shit back then. And, you know, they did a lot of things the way that they believed they wanted to do them, whether it was right or wrong, it doesn't matter. But when you think about the fact that this guy was down in there and they had to wait and watch, why they couldn't build it before, I do not know why they didn't. Maybe they should, you know, but they needed to get him. There's a reason that they had him on the res because they could do what they wanted to do. They had already stopped hanging people in the state of Arizona by that time. They made an exception, but then when that happened, that pretty much nixed all of it, you know, and so they had to get him out of the county when they did the hanging to make it legal. And, you know, that's the story of Arizona, man. That's what we did and that's what we do, but it's a creepy story down there. And you go down to that dam and you're by yourself. There's nothing around, man. You're down there. There's nothing there as far as people go. And you can see this old dam, you know, they built the gallows for him. Yes. And you know, you still picture that when you look down there, that that would have been, what they seen. And they built, and again, they waited till they got it finished. And, so they built the gallows and, they waited for his, them to get done. And then, by that time, I don't know if that was sunrise when they finally got it finished, they dropped him and it didn't work out too well. They didn't have any practice. Maybe that was it. And practice, we all know, as the story goes, practice makes perfect. And I've always been, there's a couple stories about execution in the state of Arizona that I've always been intrigued by. And Eva Dugan was always one of them as well. That was the last time a federal case was handled like that, is when her head got popped off and it rolled. In the old days, in the good old days, they used to have a galley there that people would watch, you know, and they would watch this execution. And, you know, you've seen my video of the nooses, and those were all custom built. Eva Dugan's did not, it didn't work, and it snapped her head off. And when her head rolled off, it rolled to the people's feet that were there watching, and I guess it was not. It was not a pleasant sight. I guess people passed out. It was pretty unbelievable. And so at that point, they didn't do any more hanging federally, but they made for Earl, they made a exception to the rule in the city of Globe. You know, where the jail sits now, a lot of people talk about the jail in Globe, and they talk about, that is where they used to hang people. So where that jailhouse is now, the jailhouse in Globe that's supposedly haunted, I'd say yes. Before that was an area where they had gallows set up where they used to hang people. And there's pictures of guys getting hung up there and on that corner. So a lot of thought processes, whether you're a believer in the paranormal or you are not a believer in the paranormal, one of the things that you definitely can see is that they hung plenty of people on that corner. And the amazing thing about Globe is that's a big jail too. So they knew that with all the stuff going on and the lifestyle and all the things that were happening in the city of Globe with the mining, they knew that they were probably going to fill that jail, and they did fill that jail. And so they had to find other means to take care of the people at a certain point. And they did the work themselves. And again, that's what makes that place highly susceptible, I guess you could say, to maybe a spiritual stuff. The basement of the courthouse is pretty bizarre too. So if you saw that place where I said, and he walked right across here, in Globe, they have an incredibly interesting thing where the second floor, goes across. There's a catwalk. And that catwalk goes into the courthouse. So you don't even have to go down on the street. You walk right across the alley, across that bridge. And that truly is the bridge of size. And so they go to the courthouse, and then they come back after their sentence. Wait for their sentencing. They go back across. And more than one person has decided that it'd be an easier way than to deal with whatever they're getting ready to deal to is just swan dive off that onto their heads. And that's happened at least once, and I think maybe twice, that has taken place, where they have decided that, you know what, we'll figure this out. We'll make a quick, we won't have to spend 33 minutes trying to hang. We'll just drop down about 9 seconds from here. And that happened more than one time. But, you know, you go in that jail, and I mean, it's a dark place. There's no doubt that's a dark place. You go to that bridge, and that bridge is a dark place. You know, you go to these locations and you wonder, I want to know with you guys, what do you think? So you're looking for an apartment in Scottsdale, and you're looking for a location, a condominium, or maybe just a room. And let's say you find out that you are in 132A. Do you stay? Do you give it a whirl? Or do you decide not to? What's your choice out there? What does anybody think out there? What would you do? Would you be comfortable being in a room, staying in a room that you know that, you know, it was brutal violence, right? I mean, a brutal murder. Would you feel comfortable being in that room? Would you feel comfortable to be in the room where they cut up the women in the trunk murders? Would you be comfortable in that? Would that be something that you'd be comfortable in doing? Now, you know, I knew a little bit about Bob Crane. You know, I knew a little bit about his story. I knew I'd heard about that went on. And I didn't know anything about the research I did on the hanging in the bottom of the Roosevelt Dam. Now that I found out, and intrigued me. But the next murder in Arizona that I had no idea happened, and couldn't believe it when I read it. And a lot of people, it's not a secret, but a lot of people don't know it. And it was incredibly intriguing to me, you know, that I'd never heard of the story, and I'd been through this town so many times, and I'd been by that motel so many times. And to put this character's name out there, I was like, this is intriguing, because I never knew this happened, you know? And again, it's not a secret. It was on the tabloids even, and I missed it. I don't know how the hell I missed it. So let's pull this down and let's take a look at 3. The man who loved cat. And, you know, I could have put the whole cat dancing down. The man who loved cat dancing. I didn't do that because it's a short. If somebody will get it, somebody won't. That could have been the name of Murder 1 with Bob Crane, as the man who loved cat. So, I mean, it really, these stories are pretty incredible. Pretty unbelievable. And we're going to go, and we're going to change the screen up here, and we're going to pop into Trace. So let's get on with Trace and let's chat and let's talk about the man who loved cat. In a hotel room in the Travel Lodge in Gila Bend, Arizona, there was a body on the floor, a pool of blood. He had marks on his arms that looked like he had been in a skirmish. But no, folks, if you thought that, you would be wrong, because that was an overdose. An overdose, you might say. How could that happen? How could a man be laying in a pool of blood, gashes on the back of his neck, scratches on his arms, and it be ruled a suicide? Well, maybe that's the reason they haven't had a murder in over 100 years in Gila Bend. Maybe their coroner is a little biased. Or maybe it was foul play. On February 10th, 1973, in between Ajo, Arizona, and Gila Bend, Arizona, they were shooting a movie, The Man Who Loved Cat Dancing. And that movie was filled with Hollywood stars and Hollywood power. Sarah Mills was the leading lady, who was a British actress. And the man laying in that pool of blood just happened to be her business manager. She was married to a Robert Belt, but this 26-year-old David Whiting was her business manager. And now he was dead. The movie they were shooting, The Man Who Loved Cat Dancing, was supposed to be the next Hollywood hit. They had spent the money to bring in all the major players to a small town in Arizona. Well, it happened to be on February 10th, 1973, happened to be Burt Reynolds' birthday. And he decided that he was going to celebrate that birthday and bring a lot of the cast members. And they were going to go to Ajo, Arizona, to the Palomino Club to celebrate that birthday. But David Whiting was not invited to the party. So they went and they had a joyous occasion in the Ajo, Arizona area at the Palomino Club. They got back late, went to the Travel Lodge bar, and had a nightcap. Well, Sarah Mills and Burt Reynolds, the star of the movie, went to Burt's room. She came back at 3 o'clock in the morning, and David Whiting was in the room, and he had asked her, "Where have you been? Why have you been hanging out with strange men?" So was he a business manager? Was he not? She had stated that day that he had tried to make advances to her, and she had turned him down. Now, she was his employer to some degree, so that doesn't make a lot of sense. She said that the individual, David, had thrown her around the room, and she had yelled, and the nanny next door, who had Sarah Mills' child in the room next door, heard, got Burt Reynolds, and by the time Burt got there, David was gone. She, being afraid, not wanting to be alone, spent the rest of the night in Burt Reynolds' room. Well, the next morning when she went back to her room, that's when she saw the scene, the body laying lifeless on the floor. She said it was clutching a pill bottle. Now, remember, the story went that they'd been in a scuffle, but when the police came, it was much more than a scuffle, apparently, and there was Whiting laying in the floor. Now, they said he was clutching a pill bottle, but there was no pill bottle there. Reynolds said he had taken the pill bottle, but he forgot where he put it. The big power of Hollywood came down. All the Hollywood lawyers came down, and all of a sudden, even the people in Gila Bend, all the police stated that now they'd been coached on what to say. And now, all of a sudden, Sarah Miles said that she had a physical confrontation with Whiting in the room, and that's where those scratches were from. You know, Jed Mulford Windsor of Gila Bend stated that he knew that Burt Reynolds murdered Whiting, but he was afraid that he would end up in a wood chipper, even as a judge, with all these high-powered lawyers and all of this money coming from Hollywood. they stated that the two would have to go to court. They stated we couldn't go to court. That's $25,000 we would lose. So they went to the coroner's inquisition, and that was it. And Burt Reynolds walked away from murder. You know, how could you live with yourself, I guess, the rest of your life? And I guess the reality of it is that I guess you do. I guess he did. Did he ever believe? Did he ever feel remorse? You know, we know he had been partying all night. There was also people saying that he was doing more than just drinking. No, Lonnie Anderson, his ex-wife, said that he was physically abusive to her, whether that be true or not. But this is a case of the reason why there's never a murder in Gila Bend, Arizona, because they just have a lot of people that want to kill themselves. It is funny how Hollywood and power dictate the law. So I guess you could say this was the case of the worst suicide in Gila Bend, Arizona. Burt Reynolds, the man who loved cat dancing, loved cat dancing.